I don't know how that roster has been top five defensively throughout this year, and I sure as hell don't know how they became top five offensively in the month of April. This is some wizardry. Last night, the Knicks streak, which was unbelievable. I mean, it was a 9-game winning streak. got snapped by Chris Paul, who was barking at anybody that would listen last night as he hit the threes down the stretch, and he ended their winning streak twofold. Number one, this is not, in my mind, a demerit at all on the Knicks. The Suns are better, and they are significantly better than the New York Knicks. The run that the Knicks were on is absolutely incredible. And just for point of view on this, the Knicks for the, I went and looked this up yesterday. If we just went to April, they have been generally in the tops in the league in defense throughout the year. They have been, you know, anywhere from 7 up at any given time. For the month of April, because we're here at the very tail end of it, the Knicks are 6th in the NBA in defensive rating at 108.5. The Knicks in the month of April, and this is what was shocking, have had the 5th best offense in the NBA for the month of April. Now, the defense thing, we knew that Thibodeau team, and they've been great defensively, and that's probably why they've exceeded expectations all year. But 5th in offensive rating for the month of April? And look, we're at the end. We're at the end of April. And for them to have a top 5 offense over the course of this month, despite them getting done in by Chris Paul last night to end that win streak, is rather incredible. I don't know how that roster has been top 5 defensively throughout this year, and I sure as hell don't know how they became top 5 offensively in the month of April. This is some wizardry that is going on.
You know, and the interesting thing about what you're touching on here is the fact that Tibbs and Monty Williams on the other side for Phoenix are two of the leading coach of the year candidates. They've both done an unbelievable job all year long. And with the Knicks, I think we saw some sprinkles of what makes their defense special, even when the Suns were scoring. Like, Julius Randle made it hard on Chris Paul on some of those possessions down the stretch. You know, he is a really good defensive player, coming from being a negative back in Kentucky, a negative even just a couple years ago on defense. It's remarkable what he's done. And offensively, I think it's a couple of things. It's the fact that Julius Randle is one of the 20 best players in basketball past couple months. RJ Barrett coming along, and just the tweak in the minutes. You're seeing Elfrid Payton. He used to play more minutes than Derrick Rose, used to play more minutes than Bullock, and used to play more minutes, I think, more than anybody in the guard wing rotation. And now his minutes have dropped significantly, only 15 minutes last night. So just a little bit of a shuffle has helped the Knicks offense. And for the Suns, man, I mean, I know they had that loss last week, but they're legit really good, and you can't count them out with the pieces that they have.
Last night, this is when you got to perk up a little bit. They're playing a team on a 9-game win streak on the road, and Jay Crowder wasn't in that game last night. Dario Saric wasn't in that game last night, right? And these are guys that are going to be top 7 guys, you know, hopefully when you get, in the most high leverage games, and they're still able to win. This morning, Steve Ilardi, at Dr. Ilardi, who is the creator of Real Plus Minus, I hope I'm getting his name right, sent to me, the Phoenix Suns take seriously Chris Vernon's theorem, don't play guys who suck. They own the NBA's second best record, despite having no players in the top 25 of estimated plus minus. How their top 9 guys are all good, all with estimated plus minuses greater than plus 0.5. And so it is fascinating to see that when we're looking at that, like the estimated plus minus number that he put up, an advanced number, that they don't have anybody like exceptional in that, but they also don't have anybody crappy. And the whole idea, you know, years ago I talked about how, especially as things get evened out in the NBA, where you can't just outspend your opponent or spend a fortune on guys. It is the acquisition, not having to play guys that you lose like hell when they are on the floor over and over again. And if you could somehow minimize that completely or eliminate that, that you would be so much better off. Just don't play guys that suck. And I'll be damned. Like, according to this, he's saying they're top nine guys. There's nobody of those top nine that you bring in that it's a, like, they lose when he's on the court.
I mean, even some of the guys on the list, like he sent, the top nine typical rotation players were all in the good category for his stat. But even some of the guys like Javon Carter,
sure,
Torrey Craig, it's not like they're horrible players. Those guys can come in and do a good job for you. So, you know, this Suns team is so deep and they're able to withstand a guy being out for a game or two or three or a quarter or two. And, you know, some of the wins they've had over the course of the season have just been remarkable, and they've been remarkably consistent, and they've gotten better over the course of the year too.
They're one game back, Kev.
One game back from the number one spot.